everyone. Nice to see you all. I'll just wait for the sound to come up. There we go. That's us. We're online. It's great to see so many people here. A few new faces as well. Some have travelled quite far to be here tonight. So thank you, everyone, for making the effort to come out to our Carols by Candlelight service. We've got a packed programme tonight. I can't promise you that we'll be finished on time, but we'll try our best to make that happen. Now, I know a few of you heard that when you were coming tonight, there was going to be a meal afterwards. But with the recent restrictions changing, we've decided not to do that. So we had to unfortunately tell Marion Farrell to take back the lovely Christmas dinner that she prepared for us all. She wasn't able, unfortunately, to let us eat this tonight. How gutted are you when you look at that and you see that on the screen? But thank you, Marion, for preparing that. You'll just have to enjoy that yourself at home tonight, I'm afraid. Now, tonight, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be celebrating with some mince pies. No, we're not actually going to be doing that. What I want you to do, if you feel young enough to do this, is I want you to keep an eye out throughout the service for any mince pies that you might see running across the screen, because we left this lovely plate of mince pies out in the foyer and Ken Newbery came along and he took a big bite out of one of them. And you know, that poor little mince pie, it really was startled. And in the moment that Ken took the bite, it basically said, "You're not going to finish me off." And it went scampering away. Now, we're not getting the sound coming out the thing just now, just to let you know. I'm going to go back just so we can get this right and make sure that the sound is working properly, because we should have had a couple of noises there. Anyways, let's try that again. So the little mince pie, as I was saying, it got quite a startle. Nope, still no startle. Let's try this again, shall we? I'll give the guys a wee minute, because if we can't get this right, then you're not going to hear anything else for the rest of the programme. Let's see. I'm not going to do that again, by the way, that wee intro. There we go. And so there he was. He woke up and he said, "You're not going to eat the rest of me." And the little mince pie went scampering away. Now, he's making his journey as far away from Bethesda as he can possibly go tonight. And in the process, you're going to see him whipping back and forward throughout the service. So you have to keep your eyes peeled. And children, listen carefully. If you can tell me by the end of the service how many times the little mince pie ran across the screen. I've got a bag of goodies here, but I've got a big bar of dairy milk for the person who can give me the exact number of times that the mince pie ran across the screen. So you'll have to keep your eyes peeled for the little mince pie. And it does extend to adults as well. If you can tell me the number, then I will make sure that you get a little bar of chocolate. But the first person, and I'll get you to shout out at the end, we'll maybe ask some of the children first. First person will get that big bar of chocolate. Now we're going to start by listening to a song. It's not going to have any video on the screen, but I want to just bring us into the theme for our night together. I want us just to come and focus on the reason that we're here. We're here to celebrate through song something that happened in history, that's written down in the history books, that absolutely happened. That is when God became a man and came and made flesh and dwelt in this world amongst us. So I want us really to get into that tonight. And I want us to celebrate through song this evening. That's what this is all about. And I'll say more about that before we have the rest of our program. So let's listen to this beautiful song together as we put ourselves in this right frame of mind.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, oh, come, let us adore him. Bow our hearts before him, for he is Christ the Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Christmas is the greatest story this world has ever known. It is the only story that guarantees us hope, peace, joy, and eternal life. It is the story of God becoming man. It is the story of history. It is the story of real people in a real place at a real time. It is no fairy tale. It is the truth. Tonight, we celebrate the truth together through song and raise a sound to praise the author of this incredible story. Will you lift up your voice? Will you open your heart? Will you give thanks for God's rich and amazing grace, his incredible gift to us, his Son, Jesus Christ? Or will your lips remain silent tonight? Will your hands clasped shut, unwilling to receive what God freely offers to you? The story can breathe life into your soul. It can illuminate your darkness. It can change your Christmas forever. Will you believe it?
Thanks very much, Chris. I was a bit hasty, Naomi, earlier on there. But don't worry, you'll get your opportunity. So tonight we're going to be singing Christmas carols. Now, I wonder if you've ever asked the question, what is a carol? What does the word carol mean? Well, it means to sing in an especially joyful manner. And the key word in there is especially. So that's what we want to do tonight. We want to sing in an especially joyful manner. That's the challenge that I set you tonight as we go ahead and sing our first song this evening. Now, as the band come up, I'm going to read Psalm 95, which says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and with song. For the Lord is the great God, the King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and in his hands he formed the dry land." The psalm goes on to contrast what we've just read there. It says, "Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." That's Psalm 95, verse 1 to 7. When we come face to face with who the Lord is, this has to be our response. And so let's respond by singing, "O Come, All Ye Faithful." That's our first carol tonight. If I forget, then feel free to crack on for
me, guys. Okay, so this first reading is from Luke chapter 1, it's verses 46 to 55. My heart praises the Lord. My soul is glad because of God, my Saviour, for he has remembered me, his lowly servant. From now on, all people will call me happy because of the great things the mighty God has done for me. His name is holy. From one generation to another, he shows mercy to those who honour him. He has stretched out his mighty arm and scattered the proud with all their plans. He has brought down mighty kings from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away with empty hands. He has kept the promise he made to our ancestors and has come to help and has come to the help of his servant Israel. He has remembered to show mercy to Abraham and to all his descendants forever.
Child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping,
whom angels greet with anthems sweet, or shepherds watch our keeping.
Why lies he in such mean estate? Why locks and lamb are feeding? He bends our fear for those who hear. The silent word is pleading.
Mary. Let's pray. Lord God and Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come together this evening, that we can sing these songs, listen to these songs, that we can come together in person or over Zoom, that we have that technology, that we can enjoy the atmosphere and the lights. But Lord, I pray that in this time of Christmas, when there's much distraction and much to think about, that we would be solely focused on you. I pray that we would forget about the Christmas dinner, forget about the Christmas day and the traveling and all the other many distractions that may be in our head, and that we would just come to behold you. I pray that as we think of the baby in the manger, we remember that this is the one in and through and for, through whom all things were made. That we remember that this is God incarnate in the flesh. We remember this, and that we would be humbled. I pray that we would remember not only Jesus as he came to fulfill the promises of a Messiah coming, but that he fulfilled those, that he lived a perfect sinless life and yet became sin for us, that whilst we were still sinners, Christ died for us, that he died in the cross, that he rose again, and in him we can have new life. And that as we come and we think of Jesus as more than just being a baby. We think of Jesus as seated in the right hand of God, enthroned forever. And we come to rejoice and enjoy that. We enjoy you. We pray that our hope at Christmas, our peace at Christmas and beyond, our hope through this life and our hope and our joy through all eternity is in Christ, that we would come to enjoy you, behold you, love you, honor you, glorify you. The heavens declare your glory, the earth is your handiwork, all that which is around us just reflects your glory in a little bit. So I pray that as we come here, we would be humbled, that you'd work in us through your spirit, through hearing your word, that we would come to behold you, to adore you, that this would be all about Christ. Christmas would be about Christ, that our lives would be about Christ. I pray that you bless this time this evening. I pray that those that might not feel very Christmassy, who might not enjoy Christmas all so much and feel that it's all very fake, would know that you are the great reality above all things, above all creation, before the earth and after it. I pray that to the weak, you would be their strength. To the weary and the broken, you would be their healing. I pray that you would humble the proud. And I pray that you would lift up the meek and the lowly. I pray that this would all be to your glory and in your will. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Calvin. That was a lovely prayer. Powerful. I'm going to sing a solo now, and it's the song O Holy Night. And it's one of my favorite Christmas songs because it just seems to resonate with the beauty and the majesty of Jesus, doesn't it? The music combined with the words, there's something regal and magnificent about this song. And also within it, there is that response that our willing hearts must bring, that we fall before this one to worship him and find life in all its fullness as we do so.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. The dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary soul rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees. angel voices pronounce.
That everyone clapped after that, because I was going to make sure that you did, because that was phenomenal, Gordon. Thank you so much for blessing us with that beautiful song with your voice as well. Thank you. So we'll give Gordon a moment to catch his breath, but we're going straight on to our next hymn, which is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. So we'll stand together and sing this one. Hark the Herald Angels Sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners have been reconciled. So let's stand together and sing this one.
Mercy mild, God and sinners.
Excellent singing so far, everyone. We'll have our second reading now, which is the angel song. Now, you'll notice a theme. We're looking at songs that people sung during the time of the Christmas story as recorded in the New Testament. And the angel song is very short, but I want you just to grasp the power of what these beings spoke as they sung from the heavens. They said, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom he is pleased." Glory to God, peace on earth. Now, how do we achieve peace on earth? Only by glory to God. That is the only way that peace will come, when God is glorified and given his rightful place. And who are those with whom he is pleased? Only those who are found in his Son, those who belong to the family of God through the person and because of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so these words that we see before us, short though they may be, are incredible. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom he is pleased. And you can see with our starry background, heaven is a high and a lofty and a very scary place, but God is the one who created it all, and he rules, and his dominion is over all of these things. So that is just magnificent for us to acknowledge tonight. We're going to listen to a song now. It's a good few minutes long, but again, it is a beautiful worship of God through song. And the song is called Gratitude. So let your heart be lifted up as you watch and listen to this video.
All my words fall short. I got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is your hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart in your heart. You get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of love's arms. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside.
That's a powerful song, seeing someone worshipping God that way. But, you know, sometimes we see things like that and we think, that's not me. I couldn't, you know, sing like that, you know, move like that, be, you know, transported to a place where I'm totally not distracted by anything else and I can just worship the Lord like that. But he says something in that song. He says, all that I have is a hallelujah, and I know it's not much, but I've got nothing else fit for a king. And that thought really struck me that, you know, when we come to worship God, that we just come with a hallelujah. We just come with hearts of thanksgiving. We have nothing else that's fit for a king, but he is a king who receives us. And that's a wonderful truth that comes out at Christmas time. And so let's sing Joy to the World together and lift our hearts in joy and gratitude to the Lord and singing hallelujah for all that he's done for us. And then after this song, Cam is going to come and do a reading again.
first verse again. Joy to the world.
Zechariah's song. Let us praise the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. And he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies, to enable us to serve him without fear and holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life.
Let's sing Silent Night.
Christ the Redeemer.
So we have another little singing treat. Anna's going to come up and sing Christmas Isn't Christmas for us. So Anna, would you like to come down to your little microphone? And Neil is going to play the piano for Anna as she sings. So we'll give her a wee minute to get set up. Maybe we should give Anna just a wee quiet clap as she comes up. Well, we all know which solo performance we will remember. Sorry, Gordon. Thank you very much, Anna. That was very good. Thank you. Now, I'm going to invite Ken to come up and to bring God's word to us. Ken is going to speak to us, and he's going to pick up on some of the readings of the songs that we read together from the Bible tonight. So we'll let Ken come up. And then after that, we've got a couple of more items before we finish our service. Thank you, Ken.
I think the guys are just working on the technology to get the PowerPoint ready. It's great to see you all here tonight here in Bethesda, and also you folks in Zoom. I hope you're having a good time there at home. Terrific to have these singers, and I think they're on the way. Yes, well done, guys. Thank you. Because on Saturday there, a number of us were down in the square, and this was the correct place, but it's the wrong day. I forgot to take a photograph of us. So that's the Baptist Church doing their stuff with the nativity scene. And there it was great to celebrate the birth of Jesus down in the square. And I think it was when we were singing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, that near me I heard, I think it must have been sopranos. We've got sopranos on the slide coming up, next one. They're coming soon. But there we are, the sopranos. They went way up high just as we came to the end. It was absolutely wonderful. And it's terrific to have a good song to sing, isn't it? We've all got our favourites. And one of them, for me, is Gordon Weir singing Holy Night. It was wonderful. And Anna is in there as well. So great to have these good singers with a good song. And Lewis has selected three songs that were recorded by Luke about the life of Jesus. And we're going to pick out a main part from each of these songs. Mary had visited her cousin Elizabeth, and they no doubt were comparing notes about their pregnancies and thinking about the future of these special sons that they were going to have. And it's great in our own fellowship here to have some folks who are thinking about babies coming, mummies and daddies to be. And possibly Mary and Elizabeth were something like the prenatal classes that these expectant mothers might be attending these days. And there's also a young lady way up north, well known to us, in a similar situation. But Elizabeth was speaking very highly of Mary. We read it, verse 42. "Blessed are you," she says about Mary, among women. And then, "Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." So Mary was really blessed. And Naomi read Mary's song to us from Luke chapter 1, at verse 47, sometimes called the Magnificat. "My soul glorifies the Lord," and how Mary worshipped the Lord. She really was an amazing young woman. She was humble and also obedient to the word of God. At verse 47, 48, she says, "My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant." Because, you know, like all of us, Mary was a sinner who needed a savior. Isaiah says, "We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Mary's song was joyful because she rejoiced in God, her savior. Unlike Mary, there are many today who think they don't need to be saved from their sins. They think they're okay, maybe because they're proud of who they are. Maybe because they think they're so powerful. Maybe because they've got plenty of dosh and they're rich, so they don't need God in their lives. Verse 52 tells us in Mary's song, "He, God, has scattered those who are proud and brought down rulers, the strong ones, the powerful ones, from their thrones." Verse 53, we read, "And he has sent the rich away empty." Like the rest of us, Mary was a sinner and needed a savior. A song of joy, we've been thinking. How wonderful it is to come and celebrate together in singing. But Mary's song there tells us that there's sin that needs to be dealt with. Mary recognized that God was merciful. Verse 54, we read, "He, God, the mighty one, was remembering to be merciful." That takes us to Zechariah's song, because there it speaks about mercy and about salvation. When Zechariah did as he was instructed by God to take his son and give him the name John, this was going to be the one who would later be referred to by many as John the Baptist. He was going to be the one who would grow up and he would prepare the way for the Lord Jesus. But not only could Zechariah speak again because he had been obedient, he could also sing. And so we have Zechariah's song that was read to us by Cami. He also mentions salvation for us, speaks about forgiveness of sins and mercy. Verse 77, "Because of the tender mercy of our God." Zechariah's song speaks about mercy and salvation. As a wee boy of about 7, and you folks might have been in a similar situation, but I think better behaved than I was, because I was sent for the groceries. That's not really me, but it reminds you of an idea of a wee fella going for the groceries. And I came back and I had tuppence in the change. And neither my mum nor my dad were sufficiently responsible to ask me for that tuppence. So you can imagine what happened. Time went on, and I thought, nobody's going to ask for this tuppence. So there's a wee sweetie shop across the road, and away I went, and I made good use of the tuppence. But I wasn't smart enough at 7. Maybe at 8 or 9, I might have been a bit better. But there I was, chewing away in my sweeties. My dad says, where did you get the money for your sweeties? I found it. All right. How much did you find? Tuppence. Now, that was really stupid, because in these days, you didn't get 2 pence pieces. So I very quickly realized I was in trouble, because my dad went on. He says, where did you find the tuppence? And I says, well, is it Percy Street? I found 1 penny at the top of the hill and 1 penny at the bottom of the hill. And I knew they had messed up the case for the defense. Not just me, but my mum and dad also realized that this was not the truth I was telling, that I had spent the money and I had not, in fact, found it. But I couldn't believe it. I really could not believe it. When my mum says to my dad, quietly, without thinking, I knew, just leave him alone. And I definitely couldn't believe it when my dad did just leave me alone, because I knew that I should have been shamed. And in normal circumstances, I would certainly have been disciplined. But mercy was shown by my dad, and tender mercy shown by my mum. And God is merciful. He doesn't give us what we deserve. He is a merciful God. And he was sufficiently merciful to realize there was a problem with sin and that he would have it dealt with, because that's the purpose of Jesus coming as a baby. That's the reason for Christmas, to be the Savior. Then still, when he was a baby at the temple, old Simeon took him as a child, Jesus, in his arms and said, my eyes have seen your salvation, he says to God. To make that possible, Calvary's cross was inevitable. And there Jesus took the punishment for our sin, so that a God who was holy would be able to forgive sins, and that we would know the path of peace Zechariah sang about. He mentioned his mercy and his salvation. Verse 77, when John was to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, his son John was going to come along and let people know about this wonderful salvation, this wonderful Savior. So Zechariah's song tells us of a salvation to be accepted by each one of us if we want to be put right with God. Our final song is the one by the angels. The audience was a group of shepherds living in the fields looking after their sheep. They weren't powerful people. They had nothing to be particularly proud of. They would not be wealthy, but they'd be humble, ordinary guys. Angel said to them, don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people today. In the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. the baby was born to Mary, and Joseph was there, but to you, he says to the shepherds. And indeed, this baby that was born a savior was for them and for us. For the last few days, politicians and others have been speaking about saving Christmas, and it looks as if it is going to be saved. But Christmas that we celebrate is the coming of one who came to do the saving, not of a festival, not of a great time with family and friends, but came to save sinners. There's the hymn that goes, he did not come to judge the world. He did not come to blame. And many people get the impression that was what Jesus was like. But if we read the Bible, we find that's far from the case. He did not only come to seek, it was to save. He came. A savior has been born to you. And they were told by the angel, here's a sign that you'll know you're on the right track. Verse 12, we read in chapter 2 of Luke, you'll find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And at an old age service recently, we heard how the cloths tightly wrapped around babies like Jesus would make them feel secure. And there's a granny there in Kentucky, probably a Christian, I would think, who probably was thinking about that kind of security. In yesterday's news, we saw the video of the babies, didn't we? The tornado was coming. The gran put the babies into the bath. I'm sure it was an empty bath. And put the cloths in round about. And also put a Bible in there too. The tornado came. The bath was carried away by the wind and it landed in the garden. The babies were later to be found by the rescuers in an okay condition. Angel had told them there was a sign, the baby wrapped in cloths. Then suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared. There had been the one angel, and now there were myriads of them. And they were singing the song that Lewis read to us. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to men on whom his favor rests. Verse 15 tells us that they then returned to heaven. And because of death, the burial, the rising again of the Lord Jesus Christ, we can know peace with God. And we can have an assurance of being with Jesus from where angels came and where they returned to and where the powerful God was in the highest. Glory to that God in highest heaven. We can have an assurance of knowing that we can be with the Lord Jesus Christ, who loved us for eternity in heaven. While here with his disciples, Jesus said to them that he was going to his Father's house. By that he meant going back to heaven. And he said that he would come back for them again. The song of the heavenly angels, their coming and their going, remind us of a secure future available for us in heaven if we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and accept him as our Savior. Then we can have that assurance. So Mary's song, the sin to be dealt with, Zachariah's song, salvation to be accepted, the singing angels, a secure future available. And that's the good news. That's something for us to sing about. The joyful news of Christmas today in Davidstown, a Savior has been born to you. Amen.
Thank you very much, Ken, for bringing the Christmas story to us there and that message of salvation that's available to all of us. We've got two more items before we conclude our service. The next is a video, and then after that, we're going to sing a song called Angels from the Realms of Glory. So let's watch this video together, and we'll sing our last song, and then we'll wrap up our service.
Gathered round the table, so much to be thankful for. It's Christmas, oh how I've missed this. But through the joy and laughter, you can feel the sadness. 'Cause this Christmas, everyone's not with us.
It's the time of year when happiness and cheer won't be enough to get me through the night. I need a wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the Prince of Peace, who's strong enough to carry me.
Told us he'd be no stranger to all our sorrow and all the hurt we'll ever know. So let these gifts remind us how love came down to find us.
The wonder of the ages, the life, the truth, the way. He is a wonderful
Right, so that's us come to almost the end of our service. We're going to sing another carol. It's called Angels from the Realms of Glory. And whenever we picked this one out, Gordon's description word for this was, it's a belter. So this is your last opportunity in our Christmas service to sing, as we thought about at the start, in an especially joyful manner. After all, that's what Christmas caroling really is. So let's sing this song together in praise to God.
Thanks, Bobby. I never knew this. I thought that Anna had captured my microphone. Thank you.
Here we go, Angels. visions, brighter visions beam afar. Seek in him the hope of nations. We have seen his rising star.
Fantastic. Did you enjoy singing tonight? Yeah. Did you feel especially joyful? Yeah. Good. Then we've achieved what we set out to achieve. That's brilliant. Now, how many? That's the question I'd like to ask. Oh, we have a keen hand up down here. Now, to make this as fair as can be, but it's kind of difficult, I'm going to ask all the children who think they know the answer to this to come out the front. And I just want you to line up in front. Okay, so if you do that now, come out and line up in front of me. What I'm going to have to do for the big chocolate bar is I'm just going to ask one of you to tell me how many you thought it was. If you get it right, it's yours. If you don't get it right, I'll ask the next person. We'll keep going until someone gets the right number. He says he knows, but just stand there. Just stand there, right? Just wait, okay? He seems keen. He's confident, right? And that's what we like. So I might just ask you first, is there anyone else? No? Oh, wow. This could turn into a real scrap. Bobby, nah, get back, Bobby. Right, okay, well, since you're so keen, right, I'm going to ask you to come up to the microphone here. Can we have this one on? Now, I think I know the answer to this question. Right, on you go. How many did you see?
13.
Okay. Why don't you come up? Since there's just two, you can come up and tell me as well. I was expecting the pack out over here.
10.
Right, so we have 10 and 13. Oh, wow. So we're right on the edge here. So there's no one else. No one else. Okay, 10 or 13, right? Let's just do a quick count here. There he is, Mr. Mince Pie. So let's count together. 1, 2, 3. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'll press the button, I can see what happens. 11. There were 11 mince pies. Oh, now I think that means that this young man here is slightly closer, but don't you worry. So we'll give you the big chocolate bar, okay? Well done. But you can choose from any one of these. Right, so choose one and maybe take one for your brother as well. And if there are any other children who thought they knew but were too shy to come out, you guys can come out and you can choose a wee chocolate bar from the front, provided you have your parents' permission. So well done, boys. We'll give you a round of applause. Good job.
I think you can get a bite of that mince pie, so I'm taking one of these.
It was all based on a lie. Anyways, based on a lie, but not a mince pie. So That is us finished our Christmas service. That one didn't count. I was just, that would only take us to 12, but that would have meant you were done. So let me just take this opportunity to thank everyone for coming to our service tonight. It seems to have flown by so quickly, but I've personally thoroughly enjoyed this service, and I hope you have too. And I really do hope and pray that everyone has a very special Christmas and a Happy New Year this year. So thank you very much for coming, and feel free to stay and chat to people until you leave. So thank you very much. Would you like to say anything, Gordon, or are you? Yeah.
First of all, thanks to Ken. That was great, Ken. Thank you so much for your word. We are meeting here again tomorrow morning, Christmas morning, for our service 10:30. So do come and join us then. It'll be a fun time for all the family. And again, Sunday morning, our normal service, Boxing Day service, 10:30 again Sunday morning. Everyone is most welcome. Do come and join us.
Perhaps just before we go, we should take a moment to close in prayer. And then after that, we'll have a song play as everyone starts to chat and begins to leave. So let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that you are not just a God far away in heaven, but you are a beloved Father who took upon himself flesh, became like one of us, and you descended into the world that you created, and you came for us, you came to rescue us, you came to save us. That is what we celebrate at this time of year, Father. And we thank you for these songs that we've looked at tonight, and these special people in the New Testament who form part of this historical Christmas story, and the words that they chose to use as they were moved by your Spirit. We thank you for the truth that they spoke back then, truth that will echo throughout all of eternity. And Father, we just pray that each of us in our own hearts, we would catch that echoing of truth that's come out of this place tonight and come out of your word, that we would capture what Christmas is really all about, and that we would rejoice as we sing joyfully, as we sing carols, as we sing in an especially joyful manner. Help this Christmas to be for us an especially amazing one. And Father, maybe, just maybe, there is someone here tonight who didn't realize that that's what the story is all about, that it's true, that Jesus really came, that he really was born. It blows my mind, Father, when I look at my own son and I see him sleeping there and I think to myself, Jesus became a child like this. It blows my mind. And Father, please help us to grasp this, that Jesus became a baby and he grew up and he was a boy and he was a teenager and he was tempted and tried in every way, just like we are, yet without sin. He never failed. He never faltered. He never sinned. And he went to that cross perfect and he died there perfect. And he died for our sins, the things that we have done wrong. And because of this amazing grace, we can be joined with you. We can come into your family. And this is an incredible truth. Help us to catch it this Christmas. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.